Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. After these two nice talks, I come with something which is a little bit simpler. But I want to sort of introduce a method which is not so long available for the community and try to see how we can apply this method to fracture problems. And before I start, I just want to acknowledge the my co-workers, Fadi Aldakel, who is our expert in the group for phase field, Ali Hussein, who worked on these fracture mechanics problems by splitting virtual elements, and Blaszczu Dubiewnik did a lot of coding. And actually, you could hear already at Complus both Fadi and Blasz presenting some work on the virtual element method and other applications. I'm always happy to be here. I think this is my 14th time at the Complus, so I missed one. And it's always very nice to be in this environment, to be in Barcelona. Eugenio, thank you very much for inviting me again. And I hope to deliver something which is reasonable. Okay, we will today start with the virtual element method. And actually, since it's not so well known, I might go for a short introduction, and then I will show how we can apply this virtual element method to fracture problems. There are different ways of doing it, of course, we will see that, and maybe we can also talk about some current developments of virtual elements, but I think that I will skip that basically. You know, our university is from Germany in Lower Saxony, and Lower Saxony coat of arms are the horses, because it's an agricultural, basically an agricultural state. Besides that, we have the Volkswagen company there, but this is only one big part of the sort of innovation procedure. But why did I put this horse? Because I like to introduce the virtual element method, and there is a sort of a very nice painting or parquet flooring by Escher, where you can have the self-repeating horses. And actually, if you look to the right, you will see that here we have a horse, which actually was designed by our colleagues, Paulino and Gain, who basically also designed a self-repeating horse. And actually, this is one element. So actually, it fits very well in our state to use these type of elements. But then, of course, we have an international conference here. And so we thought, of course, that the horse is not enough. So if you look to the right, you will see here a kangaroo. You might see some koalas, some snakes, some other animals, which you can see worldwide. All these elements can be combined into a virtual element discretization, which basically is compatible, and which is convex, it's non-convex. You can see the elements can have arbitrary shape. You can have arbitrary number of nodes within every element, and the degrees of freedom are only known at the boundaries. That means you can couple them also easily to finite elements. So this is basically something which you can use when it's useful. Otherwise, you can go back to your classical finite element scheme. And of course, this has some advantages which we eventually could explore, especially if you go for fracture mechanics. So, of course, this is not the first work which was done in this area, but it was introduced like 6 years ago by mathematicians Lorenzo da Veiga and Franco Brezzi, were sort of the leading figures in this direction, and we have already applied this method to contact problems, to elasticity, to large strain plasticity, and today I'd like to focus on fracture mechanics. Why do we do that? There are, of course, many different schemes available if you want to treat fracture mechanics. Classically, you had these special crack tip elements, you had hybrid elements, classically the XFEM, which you can see down here. There are cohesive zone elements. There are also element splitting and adaptive schemes, you can use damage mechanics, and lately we have seen this already in some talks here at this conference. The phase field method is very much appropriate for that. Now, if we go to the virtual element technology, of course, we also can use damage mechanics. We can also use phase field approach, can do the element splitting technology. And if you look at the picture on the right side, you will see what the advantages of this element is. You can do actually the split. You can add new nodes. You can actually generate these sort of cracks by enforcing them or introducing them directly into the elements without sort of changing or adaptively working on that. And of course, we can also combine phase field and element splitting, which actually is sort of one possibility to really get more into the sort of efficient way, into an efficient way to solve fracture problems. Now, I already showed these sort of animal type elements. Of course, it can also have other shapes. What we do there, if you do the virtual element method, we use a specific ansatz. And this ansatz actually is done over the whole element. And of course, you have a lot of unknowns. And what you have to do is you have now to link these unknowns to the ansatz functions. And somehow the degrees of freedom have to be sort of related to this ansatz. For this, what one does is one splits the part into two, the displacement field into two parts. One is sort of the projection part, which means that we use this ansatz space which we have here. And then there's a remainder which you have somehow to stabilize in the end. Now for the part, for the projection part, we do a standard ansatz. And for the remainder, classically, we have a FEM ansatz, and we will see how to deal with that. So from the first point of view, it's maybe not so easy to see. And I will actually come back to a very simple two-dimensional case so that you can actually see how it works. So the basic idea is you work in your classical coordinate system. So you have your ansatz, one, x, y, z, as we basically have seen this classically in the books of Oleg Zienkiewicz and so on. If you want to formulate triangular elements, you can do it like that. And now the idea is that this ansatz space, which we propose, is orthogonal to the remainder. So that we have a polynomial of degree p, which is the same degree as the ansatz space for u pi, and this one has to be orthogonal to the remainder. And of course, we also have on average to be to set that the displacement on average should be the same as the projected one. Now I make it more simple because in my talk I actually want to concentrate on low order elements because they are the most efficient virtual element you can think of. If the ansatz function is like that, so that means we have linear space ansatz, then of course the gradient up is constant and the gradient of u pi is also constant, which means that we can rewrite this equation in this way. And if you take that, actually you can compute the gradient of u pi depending on the u. And that means that we can actually have this equation. The gradient of u pi is equal to that. And now the trick is actually to use the classical change of to move this volume integral or the surface integral in 2D into a line or surface integral, which you see here. And actually what you can now do on the surface, you can use an ansatz space like here, for example, a linear ansatz space on the surface to compute basically these parameters which are sort of hidden in that way. To make it more sort of clear, if we do this ansatz space here for the two-dimensional case, we have one, x, and y. We have six basically unknown parameters. If I compute the gradient of this ansatz function, I have only these constant parameters here. So it's constant, right? Now, if I use this sort of computation where I do a linear ansatz function here or some ansatz function on the boundary, actually I can compute, I see here the gradient, and here I have sort of the ansatz function on the boundary. So if I now go around the boundary starting from here and do all the computations, I can compute all these terms directly, and actually then I get directly A3, so I know actually this constant which I need for my ansatz in for the virtual element method. So I can define all the parameters. And to be frank, if you do it in low order, this one is a linear function which I integrate from A to B is basically, you even don't need an integration, you use a Gauss-Lobato rule, you can only evaluate all the function at the nodal point, so it's very cheap, basically no integration involved, you get all these things. And by A1 and A2 you get from this average of the displacement fields. So actually the method is very simple. And of course can also be extended to 3D, which I don't want to talk about. Now, of course, we want to use this ansatz in a nonlinear setting, no matter how it looks like. So what we have to do is we have to, for example, formulate a strain energy function or a pseudo strain energy function. And this depends, of course, on this ansatz pi. But of course, we also have this remainder. Don't forget it, it's still there. If we just would use this ansatz, which I just derived, we would never get a stable element because, I mean, we have too many unknowns at the boundary to really fulfill the conditions for a stable element, so a stabilization is actually needed. The good thing, if we want to compute the first part you see here of pi u pi, this term here, the c, the constitutive variables, which can be the displacement, the deformation gradient, the right or left Cauchy-Green tensor, whatever is in your functional, are constant. That means it's very easy to evaluate this part here. And of course, we also can use then some history variables, which we include in that. And then, when you do that, you can linearize this and obtain the tangent matrix related to this part here, UC. As I said here, the integration is also simple because this is constant, so actually the integration over the volume is basically the element volume times the term inside. Now, we do the stabilization, we have two possibilities. One is, in a way, a penalization of the solution, of the remainder, where you basically take this u minus u pi and penalize this with some parameter here. You can choose either alpha equal constants or being the trace of the constitutive tensor. Take your best choice, which works good for the problem, and you can work with that. Actually, we found that for the low order case, it is very good to use a different stabilization, which is basically to introduce a new sort of energy, a difference between two energies, where we define a new energy, u hat, and use this difference. This u hat, what you can see immediately is if you have a very small element size, u and u pi will be the same because then everything is constant, and that means that this term, the stabilization term, disappears and all sort of the mechanics is in the first consistency term. Now, of course, this one is easy to integrate because we have already done this. Everything is constant. This is not constant, and so we have to somehow compute that. And the idea here is to use a triangularization within the element, which actually only uses the nodes which are already there. Since we have a low-order scheme, everything is constant. Of course, it's a little bit of work, but you can compute this term, and you can compute by this the stabilization energy, and then you have basically your formulation done. The only part is that we also here have a stabilization parameter beta, which somehow we have to think about and to compute, and I actually have to see how we can compute that. How does it work? I just want to show that for a very simple hyperelastic case of the classical Cook membrane problem, you can see it here. We can have different meshes. We can have a Voronoi mesh like this one, or some special, and we can also use this kind of element mesh, which we use in classical finite element situation. And I can even here put an 8-node virtual element inside, which has a linear shape function. It's a linear ansatz, but has 8 nodes, and so it is the same mesh like a quadratic finite element mesh. And you can actually see that this performs quite well. This is actually here the quadratic element. If we take the same element shape with the virtual elements, actually we get this performance. And this is actually due to the case that we basically can sort of, with this type of stabilization, we can actually compute the stabilization parameter better in such a way that actually this gives us an optimal bending solution. For the Voronoi case, it's not so good, but in the end here, at n equals 3, which is an 8x8 mesh, which is not too many elements, we get almost the same result. And of course, we get quadratic convergence, which you can see here with this formulation. Now let me go to the fracture part. And the first thing I want to show is that we applied this method using isotropic damage mechanics. There are the classical ways. We use this formulation where we have this 1 minus d. d is the damage parameter of the strain energy. This is small strains at the moment. We can compute some equivalent stresses. We actually use a regularization technique because damage mechanics means that you have usually a mesh-dependent solution. So we have to regularize this method here. And we can compute all the terms. We have an exponential damage law. And then we can write out this term here, which we call pseudo-energy, which means that we have a sort of an energy-type formulation where we fix some variables, the damage variables, for the first derivative so that it's only the elastic part. And then in the second case, we can compute that. We only do this because we are using automatic differentiation technique, and this one gives us the fastest and the most efficient element. Now, the application is the classical Brazilian test, which is, I think, well known in the community, where you sort of apply forces here, and this is sort of fixed here, and then, of course, due to the loading, there will be a splitting of the element, and you can see here the result, which was sort of obtained classically in an experiment, and this is what we get with our virtual element method, which of course you will also get with the finite element method, just to show that this works also for classical Voronoi type elements, and we are able to get the peak value quite well of the experimental result. Now, the next is, of course, to use this methodology together with phase field. I think you have heard a lot about the phase field in this case. We have two primary variables at that stage. This is the displacement and the phase field variable. We use a classical technique for regularization of the Kreck functional using this unique diffusive Kreck phase field inside. And of course, this has this length parameter L. And just to show you how the L basically works in this case, for different Ls, of course, we'd get different sort of approximations of the field. And you can see that this moves from a very sort of diffuse field in this case to a very sharp field in that case. So by sort of looking at the L, we can actually get good results. Here, the formulation is more general, which we have used here, which is a phase field model for the brittle and ductile fracture. So we have to include in our pseudo strain energy the elastic part, the plastic part, and the fracture part. And for the elastic contribution, we only assume that the crack evolution will only be in tension. That means that G, which is sort of the degradation by the face field here only works on the positive part of the strain energy. This is a split very well known. We have a plastic contribution where we use this hardening law here, and the pseudo the fracture part of the pseudo energy is basically regularized by this term here in order to get not use a staggered scheme, but a full scheme to solve this equation and this part. So this is our model. And then, of course, you have to look what is better. So to obtain sort of a good idea what a good value for this parameter, stabilization parameter better is, you can also run some finite element solution, find finite element solution, and compare where is sort of the less deviation of this to the finite element solution. And interesting enough, for our phase field study here better, you get about 0.4 the correct value. For the elastic part, actually, you can compute this parameter from some comparison with bending states. And actually, when you do that, you get basically 0.35 to 0.4. So in the elastic case, we get the same beta parameter, which is nice because we know that we can use this beta parameter 0.4 for many cases, and we don't have to adjust this parameter all the time. So that's why we basically stick to this beta of 0.4. Now, classically, you have the symmetric three-point bending test where the crack, of course, moves in vertical direction. You can see here the results. You can see the development of the phase field and, of course, also the development of the stresses sigma 1-1. What is interesting here that basically all different methods give the same results. If you look at this table here, down here, where you have the differences between the FEM T1 means triangular element of first order, T2 of second order. VEM T2 means that we have the linear virtual element as a in the shape of a finite element with basically six nodes. So it's basically a linear element, but has a shape as the classical quadratic element, and then we have a Voronoi-type mesh. This is basically the number of steps we needed to solve it, and you can see that the quadratic element is sort of the one which needs more steps because it is sort of eventually more flexible and also not so in that way. And you can see that this virtual element method is as needs as few steps as the simple finite element technology, the T1 element, and is in this sense very robust. So we have a very robust element for this type of solutions here. Okay, we also tried, of course, to introduce some of the little birds and animals into our mesh to see whether this will distort this, and you can see that we get also there good results. At that moment, I was cheating a little bit because there are no animals in the area where you really have the sort of crack propagation, but we will see later. Then you, of course, can do also this for the ductile fracture part, and again, we get, depending on our solutions, we can compute the evaluation of the plastic strain and of the fracture part. And again, it shows that the VEM method here is as robust as the finite element methods, and we need not too many steps to compute this solution. So that's nice. Here is sort of a little bit an example, which is a little bit out of, let me say, what you really expect in experiments, is just to show how the method can work. So we have used here this for finite strains, and you can see that we really get here a very thin layer, which means that the elements can perform very well in this case. Of course, you will never observe it in any experiment because the whole thing will break apart quite a lot earlier than we can see this in the computations. Now let me come to the part where we really explore a little bit more the ideas of the virtual element method. And the idea here is that we can also introduce a crack into the element, into the formulation. And this is, of course, quite nice. So, but what we do is actually we start here with a crack, and then what you can do with classical methods from linear fracture mechanics, you can actually compute the sort of for a certain stress state, you can compute the direction of the crack, and also basically the in the two-dimensional case, the length of the sort of the next crack. So when we do that, we can basically split this virtual element in two elements and add here a new node, because it's a virtual element, it's easy to do. And then in the next step, we again compute this the field, and what we end up with eventually is something which ends within a virtual element, and actually we can even put this crack field into this virtual element because we can have non-convex shapes, so we can actually sort of put this field everywhere. So that works, and we of course have to see how it works. So the first thing we want to look at is a three-point bending test in this case. So we have here a pre-existing crack down here, and the bending due to the bending, we will of course have sort of development on the crack, and we have here a very coarse mesh to do that. And let me, I hope it will work. Let me just show the sort of the crack path here. You can see how the crack path right really moves directly through the elements, and we will basically be able to compute that here in that way. Again, we have now applied this formulation also to a more complex mesh, where we had seen this already, sort of this is a double notch test where we have this basically crack developing, and we have these holes which sort of disturb the stress field, and you can see that we have here some little animals which are basically then poorly cut by the this our crack mechanism, how to introduce of course this cracks into the virtual element method. So it's rather sort of general, this formulation, and can be used in that case. Now, of course, it's clear that if you want to have good results, you have, of course, to do a very fine mesh. And I think in the first lecture, we already have seen that if you use the phase field method together with the isogeometric approach, that of course you need to refine the mesh where you have the phase field. So the idea here was actually to combine, in our case, both techniques. So actually we want to use the phase field method in the vicinity of the crack to basically develop the direction of the crack path, and then use basically the splitting technique in the virtual element where we can split through the element level to come up with the crack path in the end. So the idea is we have a coarse mesh, we can compute the phase field somehow, and of course probably you will also start with sort of a coarse mesh which has a refinement around the crack tip, and now the computation starts and you will basically be able to sort of compute the next steps using the phase field method. And we want, of course, to adaptively refine and de-refine the mesh and cut the mesh into pieces. Now, for this, we need, of course, an adaptivity parameter or some measure when we want to sort of change this and how big we want to do refinement of the mesh. And we looked at different parameters which you can use, like the phase field parameter, the tensile elastic strain energy, or also the norm of the gradient of the phase field parameter. And you see they all show basically that around this crack tip, which is clear, you have sort of an growth, and you can use this one of these as a measure for the adaptivity, and actually in our case we use the phase field parameter because it's the most obvious one and you immediately obtain this from the computation. So now let me try to run this symmetric three-point bending test again. So again we have this pre-existing crack, and now but now we basically use, oh, where is it? I lost the pointer. What happened? Sorry? Yeah, maybe I lost it, so hope it will come back. Yeah, here it is. So we have the crack path, and you can see now that the mesh is moving together with the crack. We have sort of adaptivity and a derefinement in that way, which means that we basically can explore or can use the phase field method to basically see in which direction the crack will go, and then we can use the splitting technique to be able to derefine the mesh again so that we have sort of a certain number of parameters which are running with the crack and which gives us a good resolution on this case. So, of course, this was a very simple one because we had a straight path, so then of course the next question is whether we can also do this for a curved crack path. And a good test for that is a single edge notched, oh sorry for the mistake here, shear test. And we can try this again. So we have now the crack moving in this direction, and you can see it goes sort of in a curved way, as we know this from other computations in this direction. We have sort of a certain number of nodes and a certain number of finite elements with this discretization technique, which is pretty simple. The good thing is if you do these discretizations, it's very easy to implement that in the virtual element method because you can have boundary nodes at the element where you have the refined mesh, which have basically like 10 nodes, 20 nodes, so you can actually have your adaptive mesh directly in a consistent way sort of settled into the classical ground mesh which you use for the virtual element, because we just can adopt the number of nodes in this case. And so from this point of view, I think this is sort of a methodology which is quite reasonable and which can be used for sure also in different cases. And of course, the next thing is to do some current development in this direction, and the direction is of course three-dimensional. I just want to point out that of course virtual elements is not something which you have to use for everything. There are methods which are good for one thing and there are methods which are good for another thing. We saw this also in the talk by Professor Terada, who used the material point method for special cases and the finite element method for other cases, and I think here it's the same. I don't want to sell this method for all cases, but one where it is advantage is the one when you do homogenization, because we have complex microstructures. This type of microstructure here, which basically is sitting of a lot of crystals which have different shapes. If you do homogenization, actually, you can directly mesh this CT, which you cannot do with finite elements because you have to do the meshing of sort of these cells. These can be then in this way. Of course, if you do low order, you only have a constant stress and strain within each of the cells. And actually, Michele Marino showed quite nicely that if you do that, you can actually generate quite nice stress fields. You see if you, for example, take in a 2D sense a mesh and basically on the upper side subdivide it into triangles, your stress field is not as nice as the one with the virtual element method, and actually the virtual element produces good results. That's one thing. On the other hand, if we do homogenization, we only want to have the average quantity. So we don't need to be too exact within this part. And this is why sort of this works quite well. For example, we have homogenized for some lithium titanate this type of material, which is actually anisotropic inside, and you can see that we get this effective stress and tensor, which is quite nice. So this method works. It can be used for this kind of thing, and I think there is an advantage for this special method in that way. Now, let me come to the conclusion. I think the virtual element method is, as a generalization of the finite element, a good method. It can support different approaches to fracture mechanics, which I hopefully have shown. We can, of course, solve it for all types of problems which we have used so far. Some of the problems are greatly simplified, and our next step is, of course, to use the virtual element method together with the crack field approach, and eventually then also to use this cutting technology to sort of come up with a very efficient scheme for three-dimensional crack propagation, for crack propagation in three-dimensional solids. Thank you very much for your attention.